2009, extends the pilot program under the Clean Water Act for alternative water source projects, reauthorizes grants to help communities address the widespread problem in our community of sewer overflows, requires the communities monitor for potential overflows in their sewer systems, and notify the public whenever released with threat of public health and safety, and reauthorizes the Great Lakes Legacy Act. Our nation's quality of life and economic well-being relies on water, clean water. Our nation has invested over $250 billion in wastewater infrastructure to provide adequate wastewater treatment so we can keep our waters clean. This investment has provided significant environmental and public health benefits and contributes over $300 billion in economic benefits to the nation each year. The challenge to continue providing clean water remains, as our existing national wastewater infrastructure is aging, deteriorating, and in need of repair, replacement, and upgrade. Some of the wastewater infrastructure across America is more than 100 years old. These pipes and other structures need to be replaced. Treatment plants built in the 1970s need to be upgraded to address aging infrastructure and new environmental regulations. The nation needs to invest in projects to improve water quality. Unless we act, we could lose a significant gains in water quality that have been achieved over the last 35 years. We must revive the partnerships using resources of federal, state, and local governments, the private sector, and local ratepayers. No one sector will be able to carry this responsibility alone. We must embrace innovative solutions for increasing investment in our wastewater infrastructure to ensure that we will continue to keep our waters clean. I'm pleased with the GAO's, we'll be looking into alternative financing methods, including public-private partnerships that might be useful to communities looking for helpful options. We look forward to their report. Unfortunately, this bill contains a major concession to labor unions that has nothing to do with clean water. While I agree with the goal of the bill, I'm disappointed that language has been included in HR 1262 that requires Davis Bacon provided wage rates to be used for all projects receiving any money from the state of Baldwin Fund. We have a number of members who are concerned about the expansion of Davis Bacon provided wage requirements that are part of HR 1262. Prior to 1995, only the initial federal seed money in the state of Baldwin Funds was subject to Davis Bacon requirements. The law has never required that Davis Bacon provided wage rates applied to the other money in the state of Baldwin Fund. However, the major expansion of the application of Davis Bacon requirements, HR 1262 makes the federal provided wage rates apply to contracts using state matching funds, committing longer times to interest on money earned in the state of Baldwin Fund. In addition, the way in which Davis Bacon federal wage rates have been calculated around the country has been suspect and criticized for decades. The GAO office, the IG, and the Department of Labor found that the data on which the provided wage rates were based were unreliable. Other studies have shown rural communities love as the disadvantage of mining farming contractors were especially hard by the application of Davis Bacon provided wage. I'm not a supporter of Davis Bacon because clean water projects cost more, especially our small and disadvantaged communities who are trying to clean up their own waters, and will force states that do not have their own provided wage rate law to adopt the expensive federal Davis Bacon requirements. While I remain genuinely concerned regarding the adverse effects that Davis Bacon provided wage requirements will have on jobs and clean water, I support the legislation now.